In light of the violence against the police in New York recently, I think I have to bring some things into your, or bring things to your attention that have to do with such violence. For many years, the John Birch Society has been in the forefront trying to expose the fact that certain organized elements want to create race war, and they want to eliminate local police departments, and they will go to various ends to do so. One of the things, for instance, in promoting race war was the Crusader. Now, this is an original of the Crusader. It's been reprinted a lot, but this is how it looked in its original form. And the Crusader, if you can see it, is a picture of a black knight torching the cities of America. And the editor of this was Robert Williams, in exile, it says. He produced this in China and in Cuba to try and whip up the black communities of America into racial war. And then on the other side, you had white unity. Individuals like this that hated police, although they pretended to like the police, they hated blacks, hated Jews, that sort of thing. And so they were trying to get the white community to perpetuate violence too, like cartoons like Off the Pigs. In other words, the police are not the pigs, it's these people who are the pigs, so this is what you do with them. You walk up to them and you sock them in the face, or you lynch them, or whatever. This is the kind of thing that has been agitated for years. Now, these are examples from the 1960s. That sort of thing was going on then. As a matter of fact, an organization called the Black Guerrilla Family was actually formed in prison in 1966. And it is a Marxist organization. They claim to have somewhere around 300 members with 50,000 affiliates. But these members have taken an oath to kill policemen. And there's some evidence that they're checking into to see whether this individual that killed the two policemen in New York has a connection with that organization. There is some evidence that may be the case. Now, it's interesting to see that all of these individuals who were supporting the demonstrations in the streets and that sort of thing, the holders of the world, de Blasio of the New York and those people, now suddenly are so sorry that this has led to violence. Words mean things. Words cause actions. And when they're out there, these leftist individuals, these people who've supported communists over the years, are out there promoting and supporting these communist-led demonstrations all over the United States and the world against the police. Why would they be so surprised that it would lead to this sort of violence? We have had a long history in the John Birch Society of trying to support our local police, whether it's in the American Opinion magazines in the 60s, or reprinting articles from our magazine on terrorism, or the war on police, trying to show people that this stuff is coordinated. It has a purpose behind it. Here, for instance, is something that led to a book being written later by Cleon Skousen. But this was an official government report called A Communist Plot Against the Free World Police. And what they were trying to do was to bring all of the police in their various countries, with the communist apparatus in these various countries working to do so, bringing them under total federal control or national control, if they weren't already, and specifically in the United States. It even documents how they form mobs up to attack police formations and that sort of thing, and how to surround them in the streets, so on and so forth. That led to Cleon Skousen producing this book, The Communist Attack on U.S. Police, about 5 years later. But these were things that we'd already been exposing. This was just helpful to our campaign to support our local police. But these were things that we were documenting and showing the American people back then to alert them that what you see as the attack on the police is well coordinated and well orchestrated, and it is backed by the international communist movement. That situation, ladies and gentlemen, has not changed today. It still is the same. And as I've said recently in some of these recordings, is that you can go and see these various demonstrations online and see the common denominator throughout them all is the socialist workers or some organization like that who pre-made these signs, and whether it's London or New York or Los Angeles or wherever, they appear there. It shows organization. It shows design. These things are not spontaneous. And it's all leading to what Sharpton wants. And this is an article that I think all of you should read. We posted it online the 17th of December. You can go to thenewamerican.com. And the article is called Federalized Police and a Police Czar. Now, Sharpton wants our police federalized. It's just a coincidence that he agrees with the international communist movement, you see. But at any rate, that is the aim, is to federalize our police. We know that there are people in uniform that will always abuse that uniform, but they are the very, very, very small minority, maybe 0.5%. And other people are saying, well, we don't want the police federalized, but we don't want local police either. We need to have a privatized system. Ladies and gentlemen, a privatized system would be even more corrupt, I believe. And so we have to support our police by getting close to them and letting them know, educating them on the fact that they have to stay under local control, that local citizens need to pay their local police and have control through their city councils and that sort of thing. One of the things that's happening in this equation as well is people like that are mayors who are leftists, outright communists, and that sort of thing, appoint police commissioners or chiefs of police that agree with them. In some cities, they even appoint openly perverts to head up their police department. And so then what do you think that happens over a period of time to that police department, where the left and or perverts take over the leadership of the police departments and impose this stuff from the top down? The guy at the bottom, the guy in the street, wants to protect his community and raise his his family and be part of the community. And we need to allow them and support them to do that and be helpful by not electing these leftists into power, because the ramifications, particularly in police and that sort of thing, are awful. And so then you see a rise in the community against the police, not because the police are bad, because of what they see in the hierarchy in certain leftist cities like Chicago and New York and that sort of thing. One of the things that's going on in this, and you sure don't want this man to appoint a police czar, here is a book recently issued by Trevor Loudon. The title is Barack Obama and the Enemies Within. And it's all documentation. We don't carry it here at the John Birch Society, but it's full of documentation of Barack Obama's communist background. Now, is he a member of the Communist Party? I don't know. But since he has been a 12-year-old, the man has been surrounded and mentored and tutored by known communists and terrorists. Bill Ayers is not the only man that has been involved in this process. And so it's not surprising that Barack Obama would put a holder in as the Attorney General. It's not surprising that Barack Obama would do everything he could to support a communist program, including recognizing Cuba. Now, you know, I kind of use the analogy that, you know, the mafia has been ostracized and boycotted, and we won't negotiate with them in the city of Chicago. But it hasn't worked. We haven't been able to get rid of the mafia in Chicago. So I guess we'll embrace them, and now we'll bring them in, and we'll talk to them and treat them as if they're normal people, so on and so forth. Now, that's the same sort of thing same attitude we've got toward Cuba. And quite frankly, I'm very disappointed at the libertarians out there who think that opening up Cuba is a good thing. They don't live in the real world, it seems. We're talking about communist organizations running a country south of the border. Now, it's our fault, our meaning the American government's fault, that that country went communist, because if you are old enough to know and read about it at the time, you knew the Eisenhower administration turned a blind eye on one hand and actually helped them come to power on the other. They were warned, both inside and outside of government, that the communist organization under Castro was indeed communist, and they ignored it and promoted them into power over Batista, who was corrupt, true. But they got even a worse situation. Cuba runs Venezuela, and they're hand-in-hand with Russia and China, so on and so forth. But hey, we're going to start allowing them full diplomatic relations and all those things that go with it, including allowing spies, again, to come into our country. And by the way, all of this police, anti-police violence, a lot of it was run out of Cuba through the Vence Ramos Brigade and other things like that, right out of the Castro headquarters. So we see that coming again. Until next week, we'll see you then.